Do you all have the sheet?
Yes.
Okay. Friendly reminder that on the back are all your definitions for everything. One little discussion we've been having in the other grade levels is the engagement piece and what makes it engaging. So if you forget, there's a little definition down there. Basically, for engagement, three or more areas must be confirmed in order to mark engaged. Okay, and those areas are in the bottom corner over here. Okay, so before we set out, any questions about the chart? It's gonna be pretty much the same as the last time we did it, where we'll come out of the room, we'll have our discussion, and then your head people will mark down what we think as an overall, as a whole, okay? This should be your last one for the year, as long as you've had 9 learning walks already done. If not, we'll have to get together and make up some learning walks with you, okay? Remember, this is part of our school improvement plan, and that's what we're doing it for. One more thing, we do have a survey coming out to you. It'll come out either today or tomorrow. It is 10 questions, and then the last question is like for any extra comments that you want. It should be fairly quick. They're always sometimes, or agree, strongly disagree, things like that. So basically multiple choice, it shouldn't take too long. So give some honest feedback about it. And then next week we'll have a little meeting after school real quick, just to discuss the data we've been collecting and where we're going with this.
Everybody will?
Okay, so there'll be more information on that coming up to you. Any questions? All right, so we have to go in groups of about 4. You can go with Jim, Kasorik, me, or Mary Grace. Okay.
When is this last lecture?
So we collected some data in the second and third quarter. We compiled it. And these are some of the things, Rachel put out a little survey. So you filled them out, and these are some of the statistics that come back to us. This is really good. Most of you do feel comfortable being a walker. That's a good thing, okay? And again, we'll go through these really quickly, but you know, the yellows, greens, and purples here, we'll just try to decrease those numbers as maybe we get more comfortable with moving into next year. Because again, this will be an initiative, it's going to be around for a couple years, okay? It's not going anywhere. The superintendent is all the way in, and as I've told you, he renewed his contract this past year. He's here for a while, and this is his thing. So, you know, Johnny and Nettie's going to be coming back every year for at least the next few years. So we're going to be hitting this hard, okay? That's also good. And again, if you're one of the people that disagree, I don't expect you to speak up, although you're welcome to. But if at any point you want to come talk to me or Ms. Schuster about this, you know, go for it. Like why you said you disagree with this. I'd be glad to have a conversation with you. But again, hopefully as we go on, the comfortability will come with it. Now, this one's an interesting one, and there are some comments that come later that we'll look at. So, I have said that this is not an evaluation, so over half of you, or about a third of you, think I'm a liar. that's the only thing I can figure out, okay? And, you know, if you're skeptical, that's fine. I mean, I can promise you on behalf of Mary Grace and I, you know, when we do your formal observations, when we do your year-end evaluation, there's nothing of learning walks that get put in there, okay? Just want to make that very clear. But, you know, for those of you who are skeptical, that's fine. We'll just have to win you over in the future. Okay? This is actually the one I probably cared about the most because, again, we do not want a dog and pony show. You know learning walks are coming. Don't treat it like a formal observation where you know, really get prepared and everything. It needs to be organic. It needs to be what you'd be doing normally. If the kids are off task, that's fine. All of you in this room have some times where the kids are off task for different reasons. It's okay. Sometimes the kids are just simply on task and compliant. Awesome, okay? Again, don't try to make it theater where you're doing something highly engaging. I was gonna do it today, but learning walks are 2 days from now, so I'll save it. Don't do that, okay? And so based on these statistics, it seems like you bought into that. This is one I assume from the numbers, again, I'll be glad to have conversations with you. Basically, half of you are skeptical of whether this is going to increase student achievement. If that's what calls the end results far off in the future, again, this is a long process. This is a bit of a marathon, and we are kind of in the first year of doing this. The results may be a couple years from now as we get more comfortable and we learn more from John and Eddie. If you disagree because you're skeptical of the end result, I get it. If you disagree for some other reason, like I said, come talk to me or Ms. Schuster about it. Because we're also looking to learn from this and find better ways of making this more effective.
And I do want to add on to that. Whenever you're doing a learning walk, you're going to go in, you're going to see what the kid is doing, what the kid is working on. You can see that assignment, and you can be like, oh, wait, I kind of do something like that in my classroom. I guess the kid's not really getting out of it what I want them to get out of it. This is what I should be doing. Okay? So that is where the student achievement is going to later down the road come. Because you're going to see what you're doing in your classes and be like, oh, I need to do a little bit better than that. Okay?
And I get it. It's hard to focus on the task and not the teacher. Because we've actually all been trained to kind of focus on what's coming out of the teacher's mouth, what the teacher's doing. You are retraining your brain here. So again, I get that. It's a bit of a challenge. And again, the whole point is reflection. It would be awesome if this was 100%. I know it's not realistic. The hope in the future, it is 100% because again, the whole point of this is reflection on your part. To see what see what the task is, to reflect on it and see how you can actually power up your own lessons that may be similar to what Rich said, similar to other things.
Okay, it's jump.
Okay, so this one is the one about the positive impact on school climate. We were kind of talking about this a little bit ago. Most of you are neutral on that, so I guess that's a win. And we were kind of discussing about most of you do see the positive in it, but maybe you're saying neutral because you know a couple people that don't see the positive in it yet. Maybe that's why you're reasoning for that. So I hope that's the reason why.
I put neutral as an answer here. The first time people came through, it was 2 to 3 teachers. The last time, it was 8 to 9. So there was a pretty big group coming in, and it was very distracting for the class. The first time, it was not a distraction. The second time, it was just like a mess coming in the room.
I was going to say, and that was one of my criticisms, is I felt like I saw too much of electives. But, you know, I know there's like scheduling stuff we got to work out.
And we are still in the training stage where we're working together and we're doing it together. Mm-hmm. The goal is to be later down the road, us to just be saying, hey, you need to do 3 relearning walks this week, and you pick what teacher you go to, and you mm-hmm. pick who you go with. So yeah. It is, the ideal situation is 2 to 3 teachers because it's less distraction. So mm-hmm. I do agree with you on that. And it is nice to see what other teachers are doing, not just electric teachers or not just math teachers.
Yeah, and I don't mean like there's not something gained from the elective, but we wound up there. A couple of times.
Yeah, you got to keep in mind we're still in the training phase of it. Yeah.
And never more than one administrator, but because you'll think you're being evaluated. So, if you're also neutral and negative because you think it's a hassle, again, I get it because it's different. It's a new thing for all of us, and we already ask you to do a lot. So if you feel like there's one more thing you have to do, again, I get that. Again, we'll try to work hard to win you over.
So this one, I would hope that by the time we're all done with this training process that you are all where you think that it's positive, because you should be going into these learning walks saying, on the mindset of, how can I do better? So again, I talked about a little bit ago, when you go in and you see a worksheet or something like that, you should be thinking, okay, how can I power this up? And we'll be talking about that in a little bit of how to power up. That's our next phase in this professional development. Okay. I think this one's pretty straightforward. You have that checklist that you have to complete. We're learning in stages of that still, so we're still working on that. But most of you do feel pretty confident doing it. Again, I feel like most of you feel pretty confident on doing the learning walk.
Yeah, and hopefully those numbers increase as you get more and more comfortable. Okay. All right, so again, these are some of the comments that came back. And some of these are positive, some of these are negatives. And that's good. And some of them are constructive criticism. And one thing I'm going to try to do is talk to Rachel about when John and Eddie does our learning summit this summer, we'll try to pull him aside for a couple minutes because he is available for each school to get spent a little bit of time with. And we're going to keep this, we're going to show him some of these comments and actually have him respond to it and help us. Because there's sometimes where I read these, like, I really don't know the answer. Again, one thing I hear a lot before you even read into these is this, tell me if this is a true or false statement. If you really want me to benefit from this, come back and tell me what the kid said. Is that true for some of y'all? You actually want to know what the kid said when you talk to them? Because, leave the room and be like, what did someone say? You know, that's weird. It's hard to wrap your brain around that your kids told something to other teachers, they don't come back and tell you what they said to make you a better teacher. When John and Eddie first unveiled this to administrators, everybody kind of had to do like, what? Because, again, it's something very different. To focus on the kid, focus on the task, and actually not go back and report to the teacher of those students. It's a bit odd, and so like I said, if you're critical, it's fine. So again, think small groups of teachers will be less disruptive for classes. That will happen as we get more people trained, and getting groups two or three or four is optimal. Again, I think I've already exhausted my beliefs on whether it's evaluative or not. Is it evaluative or evaluative? English teachers, what is it? again, these right here are really, like the first one, is something I want to show to John Ethnetti and have him respond to it, but right now I really don't have a response. Again, that's a respectable comment there on the second one.
But I do think on that second one, once you start learning how to power up lessons, then that one will probably correct itself. Okay, other one. Second was my favorite one. Stayed late yesterday thinking
of
how to power up
some lessons. For those who did the book study, we got a little more in depth on that. And those teachers told me they actually did want to stay later at school and actually go back and look at some of the lessons and work on the powering up. And you're a little bit familiar with powering up from the beginning of the school year. And I think Ms. Schuster has a little activity for us here in a second.
More quotes from you guys.
Those are good ones, so we put those in.
Alright, so as you know, we were collecting data on the last two learning walks, and here's the data that we collect. So, as anticipated with the one learning walk being around midterms, most of our critical thinking level is falling in the session, almost all of us were doing recall preparing for midterms. So that was not too much of a shock for me.
Mm-hmm. And I know some of y'all get frustrated because we come in when they're finishing up a worksheet, so it's just recall procedure, or doing class lecture or whatever, and you're like, why can you come in 10 minutes later? Because I'm getting ready to do something awesome. Again, we understand that. We understand that totally, okay? So again, 10 minutes here, 10 minutes there, so these numbers could be different.
Okay, and then for the engagement piece, the second piece of data that we've been collecting through our learning walks, only about 8% of the time we've been engaged, which isn't terrible, but we definitely want to get that increased. Okay.
Yeah, but we started to catch up, we really didn't see much off task, and that's the main thing. On task is just fine, like we said. On task compliant, that's a good thing. The groups I was with saw very little off task behavior, so yeah, thank you for that.
And if you're thinking, oh my gosh, I have to engage my lessons all the time, really you do not. We've said it a million times, John Anson said he believes that you should only be engaging the students only 20% of the time. So if you think about that, that's only about 15 minutes in a block.
Yeah,
there's not too much.
He said at the last learning summit that the schools are reporting 70-80% engagement. He said it's not possible that you'd be dead. Okay? And if you've ever, I had to do interviews a couple days ago. After like 3 or 4 interviews, like I'm really focused on what people were saying, like I was exhausted and had a migraine. So it's impossible, maybe it's just me, it's impossible to be engaged 70-89% of the time. Okay? 20% is awesome, and we'll work on ours.
And not every day is going to be engaging. There's some days where there's nothing you can do to engage your task, and that's fine. It's not the end of the world. So the way you are going to engage is by powering up your lessons, which I do have a couple of activities for you guys to get a little experience with that. We'll do it together. You should be familiar with this. We talked about the speaking this school year. So there should be copies on everyone's table. Go ahead and grab one of these rubrics. So the rubrics go across. The first category is cognitive demand. Then you see different categories. So you go 1, 2, 3, 4. Then you have the connected learning, the academic strategies, and then the engagement qualities. So when you have a lesson or activity, you want to go through and rate them. Okay, so go ahead and grab one of the blue copies at your table. The first one. We'll go ahead and do that again together. And all of these lesson plans are not from anybody in our school. We got them from the teacher. All right, so go ahead and take a look at the lessons. Basically, of George Washington socks. You have some definitions there. On the back side is the actual definitions that were given to the student. Go through and try to see what the cognitive demand would be. Would you say it's just recall, understand, apply, analyze, value, treat? I'm kind of going down balloons.
Or recall. So we're looking for comparing this to where it's called.
Right, I would say it's just recall.
Yeah. I would agree.
George Washington.
And go on to the connected learning. So they just have to retrieve it, copy and paste it. They're on the computer, would they just be clicking different things?
Oh.
You're working with your team. People around here.
Are we looking at
one another?
You can look at it. That's what would have been given to the students. Alright, so for cognitive demand, anyone want to offer what they put? What level do you think it is for cognitive demand?
One,
okay. Anyone think it's not a one? All in agreement of what we're seeing, one?
Yeah.
Okay, connected learning, what would you put it at?
One
again. Academic strategies?
Two.
So one or a two, hearing both? Okay. Engaging qualities?
One.
Hearing ones and twos again, so we're kind of mixed there. And it's okay for you to disagree and think that it's otherwise. So now, the whole point of this and why it's called a power up, okay? Don Antonetti also calls it a plus one. So pick one category, and where can you do a plus one? So if you thought that cognitive demand was a one, how can you get it to be a two? What can you do to change the activity to make it a two? If you thought that connected learning was only a one, what can you do to make it a two or a three or a four? You only have to improve it in one area and one category, one number up.
Please stop staying across.
Even your engaging quality, some of you are one and two, go ahead and power it up one. Sorry.
We're staying with the crossword now?
Staying with the crossword right now. So how can you power up this crossword puzzle? Make it more engaging or make it deeper thinking for the students?
Either a couple things. One, you can maybe have your higher level kids make their own vocabulary, make their own crossword puzzle, or give them a set list of vocabulary words and then have them do it.
Yes, I love that. So if you did, if you did not hear what her powering up was, it's a really awesome idea. It's instead of giving them the crossword puzzle, have them make their own crossword puzzle. Okay? When you're having them do that, they have to pick the definitions. They have to pick how they're going to connect. So that would be powering it up for sure.
If you have
she's got a good
viewers of what puzzlemaker.com is free, right? Mm-hmm. Check it out.
Okay. Someone else had a good one? Marty?
We're all going.
You just got voluntold.
Half the kids in the room get the word, and half the kids get the definition, and they have to find each other, and then
okay. So what Marty was saying is that half of them would have the crossword puzzle, correct?
No,
they all have the crossword puzzle.
Okay, one set has definitions. The other ones have the word. Right. They have to find their buddy. Okay.
So every line.
Three, two, and three. Okay. Yes. All right. For the connected learning, where'd you rate it?
One.
Okay. Academic strategies.
Two.
Twos. And engaging qualities.
Three.
Got some threes. Okay. So what made it go into a three? Because the other ones we haven't really gotten the threes too much.
Explain and support my ideas.
Recognize expression of concepts.
Alright, so how would you power this up? Where would you give a plus one to?
We're saying like you could draw and you get like three poetic devices you have to use, and then you can get a subject, and you can create a poem using those devices.
Okay.
So you're
gonna say it a little bit louder. So Greg had a great idea. You guys want to listen to that real quick?
So they're saying like you would draw, and you draw like three poetic devices you had to use after you did this, and then create your own poem using those devices.
So drawing and creating your own poem?
Yeah.
That would definitely be the create. That would definitely take it to that four. Okay. Any other thoughts? This one is definitely a hard one to power up. Does have a lot of categories. Okay, go ahead and.
Hey, everybody, this one right here, one thing I want to mention. Miss Green and Miss She's had awesome ideas on how to power these up right here. And again, we talked about this, and Miss Lane can back me up from the book study. This is C5W Initiative is an effort based initiative. The ideas that they mentioned are incredible, but they will take time. Let's be realistic. They will take time and effort to put kids in groups, to find the time to have them create their own crossword puzzle or buddy up. So again,
may I have your attention, please? If Elmer Mariquin Gomez is in the building or at track, please come to the office. Elmer Mariquin Gomez, come to the office.
So, I mean, this is much easier. Let's all be honest. Just crank it out, all right? Make your necessary copies, get the kids, sit back and watch them. To do C5W stuff, like I said, it is effort-based. And we know you're stretched thin with time and energy, but again, you know, traditional teaching is going out the window, standing in front of the kids, lecturing, giving worksheets, and giving a task and moving on. It's going out the window. This is the new movement of education. Again, we're here to support you with it, but like I said, we understand the realities of it. All right.
All right, so the next one is the yellow one, It's a what's in your bag activity. So basically the kids have to do a food diary, track their student, what they're taking in each day on the list, count the calories. They're decorating a little bag with it. So go ahead and read it. This one is just one-sided. Okay. So like my answer, so maybe push for two. Mm-hmm. Okay, where could you power it up at? Where could you plus one it?
I think we could add maybe some evaluation to it or add math to it. So you could either have them chart out if they had carbohydrates, fats, proteins, lipids, and graph that. Or, you know, say they ate a home cooked meal. How did I feel? How did I sleep? Ate fast food, my energy level was this, and just evaluate how they were based on what they were eating.
Yeah, so that's one of the ideas I actually had. When I was going through this, taking it out, I thought, okay, yeah, they can go ahead and list what they ate for like a week, and then they can look at their food they've been eating and think about how they've been feeling and how it's been making them feel, how they've been sleeping, has it been making them sick, or have they been feeling pretty good. And then try to make some changes to their diet, and then again, go through and record it, and then compare how they're feeling between the two. Okay. Any other thoughts on that one? All right, you have one more. Then we'll get out of here. So go ahead and grab the pink one.
One more.
Oh, the pink one. Again.
They have the
next
one.
Okay, two.
Well, because we're eating it.
Right.
It's a two. Yeah. So it's kind of repetitive. Yeah. Okay. And engaging qualities. No, I'm on the first one. I do like celery too, but I don't think it's creative. Alright. Okay, so.
Fun or different?
How could you power this one up?
So instead of just in the way you're reducing fractions, have it so that they're actually like solving a problem, so maybe they're like adding or subtracting fractions or multiplying and dividing by the fractions. So they have to do a little more work in order to find out what the
separate piece of paper
or
just come
on
maybe.
Given the
amount of space. I mean you can if you want.
Or you can just change the whole problem, like make it, instead of just making equivalent, you could take it on. You could do like adding fractions and then making it from there. Okay. Any other thoughts on that one? Okay, so my last challenge for you is while we finish up this school year, we still have a whole quarter and about a half. So think about a lesson you've done this week and think about how you can power it up. Okay, so a little self-reflection right now. And then with your upcoming lessons you're doing tomorrow, lessons you're doing next week, how could you improve it? Lessons that you are doing in a couple weeks from now, what could you do to power it up? Okay, this is our next step, where we are going to go. Okay, so with your PLCs, you want to try to start thinking, okay, this is what we're doing right now, but how can we power it up and make it better for next year? Or how can we power it up and make it better for this year? Okay.
You'll get bored over spring break. This is a great thing to do.